Ezra Levant for the Rebel.media here in Paris, France. And look who's joining me. My friend Gavin McInnes has just flown in from New York City. Good to see you here.
I'm happy to be here. I sort of have this trepidation and fear, but it's not of Muslims or terrorists. I have a fear that France is losing its liberté.
I think so. I mean, earlier today I was at the Arc de Triomphe, which is an amazing monument. It's huge, it's beautiful, and if you look at its meaning, France used to win.
Yes.
France used to rule much of the world, and it was a military power, and so much of the city still has the echoes of that. The Champ de Mars, the Avenue of the Grand Army. And now it's sort of a joke that it's like Goliath lying down or Gulliver and all the little Lilliputians can get away with anything.
Well, look at the general structure of the city. I mean, not here, but you look at Boulevard de Clichy and some of these big streets. They were designed for the army to go down. You know, this whole nation has a history of revolution. Liberté, égalité, fraternité. That comes from the peasants with the pitchforks. And I'm not seeing it here, and I'm genuinely concerned that we just are so consumed with égalité that we're forgetting about liberté and fraternité. I mean, the Arab immigrants here don't care about fraternity, especially out in the suburbs. And the general mood here seems to be, so far, malaise. And I think the attack was to get rid of the gray. ISIS's flag is black and white. And they didn't choose a tourist spot like Champs-Élysées. They didn't choose the West End, which is rich. They chose the hipster areas that are gentrifying. They have moderate Muslims there. They're very multicultural. And they're gray areas as far as extremism goes. And what it was a checkmate move from ISIS saying, you're either with us or against us. I'm sick of everyone getting along. And so the liberal left, which is basically all of Paris, has said, I either have to join Le Pen and fight you or become radicalized. I'm going to just do nothing and continue with the gray. And it's so frustrating because it's going to mean more provocation. We saw this with Charlie Hebdo. Charlie Hebdo was a shove. They did nothing. And now they're getting shoved again.
10 times harder. Charlie Hebdo at the magazine itself, 12 were murdered, 5 others in the city. Well, add a zero to that. In the attack on Friday was 10 times worse, many more casualties, and yet, you know, landing at Charles de Gaulle, just breezed through passport control. They say there was an extra 1,500 cops on the street in Paris. So what? There's 30,000 cops in the city. That's like, what, 5% more? I mean, there's a nonchalance. There's no million Parisian march like there was with Charlie Hebdo. There's no heads of state coming in. François Hollande said he was really tough on terror. He dropped 20 bombs and left. I think the Arc de Triomphe no longer belongs in Paris. It should be like an old relic, like the Roman Forum or the Greek Acropolis. Today's French do not deserve to wear the uniforms of the France of Napoleon.
It's ethno-masochism and it's cultural masochism. Au bout, as they say in Quebec. They just seem to want to take every attack and turn it against themselves. This is Israel's fault. This is America's foreign policy's fault. They totally ignore the 1,300 years we've been at war with Islam. They ignore the Crusades. They ignore the reason we invented the Marines was to fight Muslim pirates who were stealing us Christians and making them into slaves. That's all erased. And they just start with the past few years. Maybe it's a lack of education. Maybe it's multicultural mongering. And I think a big part of it is politicians in the media saying, we need open borders, we need new immigrants, because our demographics aren't cutting it. And I was thinking on the way here from the airport, clogged in traffic, why is it such a crisis that our population isn't skyrocketing or continuing to go like this? Why do cities have to be so packed? I don't understand the impetus for all this imposed multiculturalism.
Well, and I understand the idea, you know, old stock French, old stock Europeans, same in Canada and the United States, just aren't having a lot of kids. So to keep the welfare state, you need a lot of young workers. But the irony there is, especially here in Europe, these new immigrants from Arabia and Africa, they're on welfare. They're not going straight into the factories as high productivity workers. Maybe they're working in low skill labor or in the service industry, but the economic justification for mass immigration falls apart when you look at the welfare demands, the healthcare demands, and finally the terrorist costs too.
Well, we both know who's in control of this influx. It's the media and the politicians. They live in the West End. They live in the West End of Montreal. They live in the West Side of New York City. And they live in the West End of London and Paris. They're all in the West. And they don't see how it affects the day-to-day. They're not in the 10th and 11th arrondissement where these attacks were. They don't understand what it's like.
And same thing in Canada. These liberals in the media and in politics who love the niqab, the face-obscuring mask, they don't live where they see that. They live in all-white gated communities. These white liberal judges who think they're so tolerant by allowing this symbol of intolerance, they don't have to deal with niqabs in their daily lives. Listen, I want to shift gears a bit. We're getting right into it. You and I are going to be here together for a couple of days, and I want to talk about why you came and why I invited you to come. I love your stuff on The Rebel. You're one of our most popular pundits. I don't know if you'd call yourself a pundit. And
if I'm getting compliments, then I'll take any adjective or noun you want to throw at me.
I mean, I think you're funny.
Yeah.
And, well, devilishly handsome. But there's not a lot of laughter here. I mean, hundreds of people murdered is not a laughing matter. But what I think is one of your strengths is you really don't care what the taboos are. If someone says you're not allowed to say that, you say, well, I'm going to say it just to prove I can. Those are all the instincts that the Western civilization is losing. Charlie Hebdo were satirical, taboo-breaking comedians. They were murdered. We need more of that.
Yeah. George Orwell said, within every joke is a tiny revolution. And Charlie Hebdo was attacked for jokes. And who was it? The Ayatollah Khomeini, who said there is no humor in Islam. And we had Stalin, who was sent people in the gulags for joking about his mustache. I think this is the perfect time to be joking, because Islam seems to be the most sensitive about humor. And if you ever want to know who is in control, see who you can't make fun of. And right now, the politically correct left has decided Islam is in control and you can't joke around. So while we're here, I want to talk to comedians. I want to talk to far-right conservatives. I want to talk to far-left liberals. And I'm determined to keep an open mind. But I'm telling you, man, I definitely smell the stench of capitulation. And we saw it happen with Charlie Hebdo. Afterwards, they said, we're not doing Muslim cartoons anymore. They capitulated. And what happened? When you give a vampire just a little taste of blood to make him go away, he gets hungrier. And now we have 10 times the carnage. Like, they're sitting there singing, give peace a chance. I'd like to give hate a little bit of some time in the sun, please.
Well, I mean, peace. And I mean, I went down to the Place de la République, and there's this great statue, Liberty, Equality, Fraternity. What were these kids have lost that vocabulary.
Right.
They've lost the vocabulary of patriotism long ago, but even lost the vocabulary of liberty and even critical thinking. I mean, they were seriously singing top 40 songs. They were singing like John Legend. They were singing the Beatles because they knew something was going wrong. You know, you mentioned Orwell. The book 1984, in so many ways, was if you lose the language, you lose the ideas. And I think a core part of that book was newspeak. If you abolish certain words like freedom, then you have a feeling in your tummy that something's wrong, but you can't articulate it. These kids, they had a feeling in their tummy that something bad happened, but what did they know what to do? So they start singing pop songs that gave them tummy feelings. Oh, if I sing John Legend, it makes me feel warm, so maybe that's the best I can muster in response to this fascist attack. I'll do some karaoke. That's what I saw last night.
Yes, they've lost their vocabulary with political correctness, but also, the Arab community has started their own vocabulary in les banlieues, and we saw that in the movie La Haine, The Hate, that was predicted this many years ago. They speak French backwards. They call la cité la chité, and they've invented their own vernacular. And to me, that sort of sums up their determination not to assimilate. They don't want fraternity. They want égalité if it means more welfare benefits for them, but liberté and fraternité have been put to the wayside, and they've done it, as Orwell predicted, via language. The Arabs have done it by inventing their own language, and the citizenry have done it by censoring themselves and destroying their own vocabulary.
Let's talk about the next couple of days. You do what would you call it, a podcast or a live stream? What do you do on
a video podcast on anthonycumia.com. We're going to be broadcasting live in a couple hours, Monday and Tuesday. And I'm going to have people in our hotel room hanging out and just talking about what is going on. And it's going to be mostly young people, mostly hipsters. I mean, It sounds funny, but this was an attack on hipsters. The area was a hipster neighborhood. It might as well be Cabbage Town or Williamsburg or the Lower East Side. And that was specifically aimed at young creative types. You know, they devastated that whole community. Everyone young and cool, basically, knows someone who died there. And I'm going to talk to them, and I fear that they're going to say, well, you know, we had it coming, and we brought this upon ourselves, and more violence isn't the solution, and basically just keep trudging through life, getting abused by ISIS and Islam. But we'll see what happens.
I feel the worst.
That's what you're doing for your Gavin McInnes show on Anthony Cumia.
Yes.
Now, you're also going to do a few monologues for us, and you're going to go out into the streets with me, sort of as my bodyguard, because I don't know how to fight. I've seen you at least... Have you ever gotten into a fight? I think you have. You talk about fighting. If I get into trouble, would you help me?
Without a doubt. My fights are like my French. It's very hard on the ears. I get the point across. I often lose, but there's some passion there and some real cultural sensitivity when I get into my fights.
Because I've been downtown with all these white liberal kids from the Sorbonne who are singing Give Peace a Chance. I know what they think. They don't think a lot. They just feel. I want to go not to the hardcore, you know, projects in the banlieues, but I want to get out a little bit from the downtown, away from the college kids, away from the tourists. I want to go to the neighborhoods that are 50, 75% Muslim, and I don't want to go to antagonize. I want to go to ask legitimate questions. Do you believe that France should become Islamic? Do you believe in Sharia law? If do you agree with the terrorist attacks? I think almost everyone will tell me no. Do you understand why someone would do a terrorist attack? Even if you don't support it, do you sympathize?
Right.
I mean, I think there's going to be a lot of questions that if I ask them in a friendly or neutral way, I think it would shock the ears of the downtown kids singing Give Peace a Chance.
Yes, and... you know, maybe we're wrong. Maybe we're going to come across Muslims who love French culture.
Well, we will.
And don't have Islam as
we will. We
religion.
Absolutely will.
Maybe we'll come across millennials who are mad and want to fight back and don't want multiculturalism to wipe out French culture. Maybe we'll find out that they've had enough, but I doubt it.
You know what? You can't spend any time in this city without seeing a great number of fully integrated Muslims. I mean, because whereas Islam has only come to Canada and the United States really since 9/11, paradoxically, Islam and France have been intertwined for generations because of their colonies in Arabia. And so there are fully integrated, fully liberal, secular, proud, passionate Frenchmen who are Muslim and Arabs. And de Gaulle himself said that is a possibility in limited numbers if they truly integrate. What you've seen is 5-10 million Muslim immigrants who have not assimilated, as you point out. They deliberately have not. They are more radical than their parents. And I that's the trouble. When you have 10 million Muslims in a country, how do you go to war against radical Islam when maybe a tenth are in your own country?
Well, the French experiment seems to have failed. They used to have a rule where if you wear a striped shirt and a beret, you're French. You can be Vietnamese, you can come from one of our African colonies, but once you're here, you're French. And that's why they don't keep any racial data. We don't know how many blacks live in Paris because they refuse to quantify that because as far as they're concerned, you're French. And that's worked for a long time, fraternity. But now they have a religion that doesn't put French first. And although the citizenry claims you're French because you have a beret, they take off their beret, put on a hijab and say, no, I'm not French.
Well, that's one of the interesting things is that France actually has banned the niqab itself. So visually, it doesn't look as radical as, say, parts of Toronto, but it hasn't stopped the terrorism. I want to throw one more thing at you, and I know this is it's good to catch up with you. It's nice to see you of all places here in Paris. I read a great column the other day by Daniel Pipes, the PhD. He studied in Cairo. He's an expert on radical Islam and Arabia. He said that this attack will drive the grassroots French to the right, but it'll drive the, he called them the 4P professionals to the left. Politicians, the press, police, and professors. So he said in the end it'll be a wash. You'll drive more people to the Marine Le Pens of the Front National, but every politician will move further to the left and say, oh, we haven't tried hard enough. We have to become more tolerant. We need more diversity education. We need more censorship of right-wingers. So Pipe says that until we have a devastating attack where he literally said 100,000 casualties, you're going to see the self-delusion on the 4P professional left dig in harder and harder and harder. And to demonize anyone who says, you know what, I might not like everything about the Front National, Marine Le Pen, but I'm voting for them because I've had enough terrorism.
I think that's absolutely true. But here's some light at the end of the tunnel. People are resenting the 4Ps more than ever. Academia is crumbling. It's a house of cards. And back right before this happened, we were hearing deans all over America quit because they're just so racist. And the academia has become a laughingstock with courses like How to Be Gay. And it's clearly just Marxist brainwashing that is making everyone into an imbecile. And there's already a backlash there. As far as the media goes, we've got rebel media, we've got the internet. There's already a huge backlash against the mainstream media. So the 4Ps are essentially ghettoizing themselves off into some satellite.
Sure. But in the meantime, they still control the law, the politicians, the information for most people, the press, the enforcement of the law, the police, and what's the last one? Professors, the source of intellectual ideas, of books, of authorities. So yes, they may be discredited amongst those who consider themselves alternative or independent-minded, but that's not most people. I look at Justin Trudeau's election in Canada as proof that low-information millennials who like to feel good have elected their selfie prime minister. And so, yeah, there may be more and more dissidents like you and me, but we don't have the power. I mean, look at the word therebel.media. We are built for opposition because it may be decaying. These 4Ps might be decaying, but they're going to control things for years to come.
Well, I'm much more optimistic than you about it. I really feel like this, we are at a tipping point, and the 4Ps are at death's door, and we're about to have a totally independent populace. I mean, look at the rise of libertarianism. Look at you couldn't say that word 10 years ago.
It's a rise maybe in, it's a niche fashion. There's no libertarian who wins anywhere. Show me a libertarian who's ever won an election.
Well, he hasn't won an election, but look how high Rand Paul has gotten. Look how much he's talked about.
I think what you're seeing is a battle between the democratic mass and the elitist 4Ps. And if you look throughout Europe, you're seeing the rise of right-wing parties, and you will see also the rise of some neo-Nazis, and they'll be held up as emblematic of all the right, especially in Germany. But I put the blame of any fascism, any skinheads, any neo-Nazis, I put the blame on the parties of the left, because they demonize people. If you call someone a Nazi long enough for saying, I don't want 750 Muslim migrants in my town of 104. Like, there was that little German town called Sumte, 104 people. They were assigned 750 Muslim migrants. Like, if you say, I don't want to be the refugee in my own town, oh, you're a Nazi. Well, if you're going to call me a Nazi, fine.
Right. Well, I mean, I hate it when we fight because it makes my stomach hurt. But right now, we're both describing the same scenario. The only difference is I think the House of Cards is about to collapse and you foresee another decade of turmoil.
I look forward to exploring these issues with you. You're going to tape your shows. They're not taped. They're live stream.
Live stream.
And
so when people see this, it'll already have happened for the Monday show, but the Tuesday show will air live at 10:30 a.m.
You have some connections and friends here in Paris. You're going to try and set up some meetings either for your show or for us at The Rebel. I'm looking forward to getting out into the street with you, because that's where we'll discover. I mean, you're the king of streeters, going up to people. You know French better than me. And look at how muscular you are.
Very muscular. So, yeah, that helps.
So you're the muscle here. I really think it's important that we talk not just to the Sorbonne class, but that we talk to Muslims. And here's the last point I want to make. France today is Canada in 10 years, maybe.
Yep.
In terms of numbers, I mean, Canada has doubled the number of Muslims in our country since 9/11. Why? Well, it just has. And we're set to double them again. And if we keep on that track, we will have, I mean, right now, Muslims are 3% of the Canadian population, maybe 4%. Here in France, it's probably 10%. So if we keep on this track, we will be where France is numerically. And there are Canadian jihadists, too. And I think that we don't have the critical mass of extremists to have terrorism like they do in France on a regular basis. But I think we'll get there. And Jews are fleeing this country. Jews are fleeing France the first time since the 1940s. How terrifying is that? Last word to you, Gavin.
Well, Canada is very European in its demeanor. Maybe it's because of all the British immigrants. But after those two attacks on Canada, we saw a similar sort of apathy that we're seeing now in France. And that scares me, not just because Muslims, extremist Muslims, are a threat to our way of life, but because our own malaise is a threat to our way of life. We need to be passionate about free speech and the right to make rude jokes, the right to be offensive, and the right to entertain each other with the thousands of years of our culture that we've built up being ourselves.
You know, the left used to love bad jokes, rough jokes, mean jokes, offensive jokes. The left used to love free speech. Parts of the left still do in the United States. The ACLU is very good on free speech. In Canada, the left doesn't bother itself with free speech anymore because it prefers the power of authoritarian censorship to debating. It's easier now that they have the power. They don't really believe in speaking truth to power because they are the power.
What a bunch of fags.
I know you said that because you're a free man and you're free to offend. And I know you. I know exactly why you said that and what you mean. Soon there will be words you can't say.
Oh, soon?
Well, you did a monologue on 30 words. On 30 words, you can't say
douchebag on TV anymore.
Well, that's maybe here en français. Douchebag, different me. Gavin, great to see you. Welcome to Paris. I look forward to spending the next couple days with you, and hopefully, we'll get out alive.
On y va.
Right on. For the Rebel.media, I'm Ezra Levant, and this is my friend Gavin.